Oh, great. Good to hear. Oh, no, not at all. That's fine. I understand. Did you say you're in St. Albans?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, that's a bit of a drive. Oh, and you, you take the bus.
But today I had a filling.
Oh, okay. Okay, good, good. Well, you can start us off with the tennis today.
Okay, let's get started. Is it just me or is it cooler in here today?
It's
cooler. Just me. Oh, okay. It's cool. It's cooler. Definitely cooler. Good news. Okay. Just some other housekeeping things. As I mentioned before, my office hours are immediately after class, and my office is back over in Farrell Hall on Trinity Campus. And I just learned the other day that they automatically lock the doors, and you guys don't have access after 5:30. So I will hold my office hours in Farrell. If you come to the front door, there's a conference room right on the other side of the front door. I'll just be doing emails in the conference room there. So if you come to office hours, just knock on the glass and I'll let you in. Not an ideal interface, but it works. So I'm there. Okay. Let's see. What else? Deliverable 1, again, just as a reminder, Deliverable 1 is due on Monday at 11:59 p.m. You're more than welcome to submit before then. And then on Tuesday, I'll assign and we'll talk a little bit about Deliverable 2. Has everyone got the Leap Motion SDK installed and the demos running? Python, yes. Matplotlib, Canopy, so far so good. No major problems. Okay. Any conceptual questions about Deliverable 1? I did get one question about the X and Y coordinates of the finger. If you move your finger to the left and the dot moves to the right, that's fine also. It doesn't need to be a one-to-one correspondence at the moment. Another student asked about, do we want Y or Z? Doesn't matter to us. What you're demonstrating with the third video is that you're able to capture all of the data from Leap Motion. You're throwing everything away except the two position coordinates for the fingertip. We don't care if it's X and Y or X or Z. That's not important. Okay.
So if we don't succeed on one deliverable,
yes.
Do you give the answer before we start the next one?
If you don't succeed on the first deliverable, no, we don't give you the answer. We ask you to go back or meet with the teaching assistant and see if you can figure out what the problem is. So if you're still having problems, go and see the teaching assistant, hopefully before Tuesday, Monday night.
Well, after Monday night.
After Monday night, yes, you're free to go and ask questions whenever. But remember that all of the deliverables are cumulative, so eventually you're going to have to get it to work on your own. Even if we give you the code, you won't understand it. You won't be able to expand the code for deliverable 2. So make sure that your first deliverable is working and you understand the code. And if you don't, go see Chris, the TA. And if you're still confused, come and see me. Okay. All right, so back to the schedule. We finished lecture three last time, which concludes sort of the introductory material to HCI, and hopefully by now I've convinced you why HCI is different. It's very challenging because obviously we're not just making sure that our code runs correctly. There's lots of other things we need to think about, like P and A and C, before we think about T, which is the technology. What does P and A and C stand for? You've forgotten already?
People.
People.
Activities.
Activities. And context, right? Okay. People differ, activities differ, contexts differ. That's what we talked about when we thought about packed analysis. You're sitting down, you're writing some new software for Leap Motion or Google Glass, and you're imagining what's going to happen when people put on Google Glasses and go out into the world, right? Some of the activity and context is going to be obvious, some not so obvious. So just as a refresher, for Leap Motion, we talked about how people differ and how that's going to impact your Leap Motion device's ability to recognize ASL signs when you start signing them. What are some contexts surrounding Leap Motion that affect its functionality? Are there physical contexts that matter here? Social context, cultural context? Has anyone tried to use a Leap Motion device with a desktop lamp shining right on it? Ken, you can try that out. Not surprisingly, it confuses Leap Motion. So if you have light that has an infrared component, it's going to get confused. If you try and use it outside, doesn't work so, right? Doesn't work so well. So an obvious aspect of physical context is where and when is the user going to be using it? If they're using it at night to learn ASL and they have a desktop lamp on their desk, that might be a problem. Might not be, but again, these are the kinds of things we're trying to think about. What is the broader context in which the technology is going to be used? Okay, so we talked about how to start to think about all those things, and once we've started to think about those things, how do we take all of those considerations and now gradually start to turn those considerations and requirements into a piece of interactive technology? That's what we're going to tackle in lectures 4 through 8 here. We're going to talk about design in the abstract. What does it mean to design something well? We're going to start with design in general and focus more and more in on design that's specific to HCI. Lecture 6, we're going to spend some time talking about specifically designing visual information. So most of what an interactive technology does these days through the interface is present things visually. What are good ways to do that and what are not such good ways to do that? And then we'll have a two-part lecture on the HCI design process itself. Okay. Okay, so let's talk about design philosophy and design process. So design, in the most general sense, is a translation process. So we're taking some need, something that a user wants to do, some activity they want to carry out in a context, and gradually through some design process, translate that need into an artifact, which in our case is usually going to be a piece of software. We want to carry out that translation process from need to product or service in the best way possible. What do we mean by best? That's where design philosophy comes in, defining what we mean by translating in the best way possible. The design process is whatever process we come up with. What is the transformation? So we might come up with two different design processes that we're going to try and apply to turn a need into a product. Process A and process B. We're going to look at a lot of design processes today. One design philosophy would say A is better than B. This is a better way to turn need into product than design process B. That's the difference, right? Our discussion or ideas about what is a good design process and what is a not so good design process. Okay, so I've structured today's lecture where we're going to look at design in a lot of different domains, and we're going to march from things that are least constrained and most aesthetic to things that are most constrained by, in our case, the technology, are much more objective. So we're going to talk about subjective design. What does it mean to design a piece of art? What is it, What does it mean to create an artifact that has only aesthetic purpose and no practical purpose? And work our way up to things that are in essence practical. They're there to support some need. Right? I've mentioned this before, HCI is a mix of left brain and right brain thinking. It's not enough to make an interface that works well. There's usually some aesthetic considerations in that interface. So we're going to look at these different domains and see how these different domains try and reconcile designing something so that it is both useful and aesthetic. Okay. So let's start at one end of the spectrum, right? Aesthetic design. Here are some works of art that were designed and executed. What are some of the design principles behind great works of art or beauty in general?
Contrast.
Symmetry.
Compliance with the golden ratio spiral.
Compliance with the golden ratio, all right. Certain ideas about proportion. Did you have an idea?
Proportion,
okay. What else? These are all things that you may consider when you have an idea and sit down and try and create a work of art, right? A design process. What are some other principles?
Cultural context.
Cultural context. What do you mean by that? Absolutely, right? We talked about cultural context last time, right? You might not all agree that these are great works of art. That might be a personal choice. It might be because of your background, culture, and so on, right? Same with interface design. You might create two prototypes for your ASL educational software. You try it out with two of your roommates at home. Roommate one likes interface A over B, and roommate two likes interface B over A, right? Again, HCI is in many ways a subjective thing. How do we deal with that? Well, at least we should be aware of the general things that people tend to be engaged by. Satisfying proportions, balance, maybe ornamentation, things that look pretty, and so on. Okay, so again, we could make a very, very long list. So here's just a grab bag of some of the things that you mentioned, right? Things that may be important in designing or executing a work of art. Resemblance to natural structures, right? This is going to come up a fair bit in HCI. We mentioned that people have expectations when they interact with the physical world or they interact with the natural world. Can we bring in those expectations to our interface? Okay, we already mentioned balance, symmetry, proportion, color, originality, right? So in art, often you're militating against balance or symmetry or resemblance to natural structures, right? Would you ever want to do that in an interface? Deliberately try and break somebody's expectations? Where might that be useful?
If it was dangerous and you wanted to.
Okay. Absolutely. So what is the best way to immediately grab somebody's attention is break their expectations about a sensory motor process, right? Well, so I did something and I had an expectation about what was supposed to happen. There's a great way to play around with that is to play the rotated mice game. I know most people have trackpads these days. But if you have a mouse at home, take your mouse and rotate it 90 degrees. And grab it in the way you would normally grab it when it's unrotated, and try and move the cursor around the screen. It's incredibly distracting, and it will immediately grab 100% of your attention. Right? Okay, that's often a lot of art movements were an attempt to try and grab attention by militating against standard ideas about what counts as beauty and what doesn't. Okay, I put in italics there, maximize ornamentation. To contrast that, again, I apologize. Now we can see why contrast is so important. Contrast on this projector is not very good. I maximize ornamentation for works of art. Often in visual design, we're trying to minimize ornamentation. I think I mentioned this last week. I mentioned a ratio. Does anybody remember what that ratio was? This. We'll come back to this quite a few times in this course, especially when we talk about visual design, which is trying to maximize the data to ink ratio. So in an interface like Gapminder, which you can kind of see here, you may be wanting to communicate a lot of information about wealth. So here's, again, GNP on the horizontal axis, gross national product, and a health indicator here. Gapminder is a way to visualize relationships between health and wealth in lots of different countries. There is a lot of information that's packed into the visual interfaces of Gapminder, but every colored pixel here is doing some work towards communicating those relationships. There is no there's no wasted ink or colored pixels in this case. What are some other principles that are important if you're trying to communicate information visually? We don't want to distract the user with a whole bunch of colors and other stuff that isn't contributing to the message we're trying to present. What are some other things that might be important? Yes?
Like you said the other day, like taking advantage of visual metaphors.
Taking advantage of visual metaphors, right? So without having to tell you, and again, there's a label there saying China and the United States, you should very quickly intuit that a larger circle represents countries with larger populations, right? If smaller circles represented countries with larger populations, that'd be confusing, right? There's a lot of visual metaphors here which make it easier for you to digest all of the information that's being presented. Okay, as another example of this maximizing data to ink ratio idea, this is a short video on less is more. All right.
I'll just kind of say, and I think you'll get the idea here.
Simplifying spreadsheets or information presented in a spreadsheet. It's going to walk you through basically removing colored pixels that aren't doing any work for you. Trying to communicate the same information in as simple a way as possible. You can disagree with some of these if you want. Okay. Same information. Go and watch the video at your leisure. Most people, when they're creating visual interfaces or spreadsheets, they make use of font and highlight and underline and color and spacing and font size and so on and so forth, right? Get rid of it all unless it's communicating some information to your users. Less is more. Okay, so let's keep marching from things that are purely aesthetic towards things that are at least hemmed in by some kind of constraint. So architecture is a great example because, like HCI, architecture tries to strike a balance between things that are visually engaging or visually pleasing or aesthetic in some way, but also are beholden to certain constraints. What are the two buildings that are shown here? There's one building on the left, and the two images on the right are the inside and outside of another building. What are they?
One on the left, St. Peter's Basilica.
St. Peter's Basilica in Rome, that's right. What about the one on the right? It's a lot closer than St. Peter's Basilica. It's at MIT. So this is the MIT Status Center, which houses the Artificial Intelligence and Computer Science Lab. Next time you're in Cambridge, it's a great building to go walk through. It was designed by Frank Gehry. You can sort of see the Gehry architecture on the outside here. The outside is very different from the inside. Why? Why no curved walls and floors?
You want your desk to be up against
the wall. Sorry? needs to be functional, right? You don't want to be walking up and down halls with curves in them. Okay. So obviously architecture can be aesthetic, but there are certain constraints that you have to meet. Same thing with interface design. Status Center is an interesting building. There's an interesting history behind it. The idea behind the building was to try and mix personal and public space. So it was to try and maximize the idea of students and faculty meeting in the hall and having a discussion about class or research. Unfortunately, in reality, it doesn't seem to hold up as well. You can walk around the Status Center and suddenly realize you're in a faculty member's office without realizing you've moved from a public space to a private space. Good idea in theory, hasn't quite worked out in practice. But anyways, an interesting example of architecture. Okay, not every building is inhabitable. Okay, let's keep marching into domains where we have more, we're hemmed in more and more by constraint. Engineering in general, there's lots of design philosophy about how you take a need and turn that into an engineering product or something that supports that need. In engineering, like software engineering and HCI, we are trying in the design process somehow to converge down to a set of requirements. What exactly should the system do? And more importantly, what should the system not do? What are the boundaries of the functionality of the system? Okay. So the system should do X, it should do Y, and so on. This is just one sketch of a particular kind of design process and design philosophy. The philosophy here is modularity. We want to try and break our design principles or requirements down into very modular functions, functions that are independent of one another. We've heard this idea of modularity of design already in this class. Where did we hear it? Sorry? The watch, right? Tempus and Hora making the watches. Makes sense to make things modular. If you get interrupted, you know where you are. If things fall apart, it's easier to put them together again. If you want to improve one module of your piece of software, you can usually improve it without impacting the functionality of another module, right? Modular designs are ubiquitous in engineered systems for those reasons, right? And it seems so obvious now that it's odd if you think about non-modular designs, right? So in a car, you have very clear modules. You have a module called an engine, which converts fuel into kinetic energy and motion. You have another set of modules called wheels that minimize your bouncing around as you travel over a bumpy road, right? Two very separate modules. Imagine you had different modules or no modules at all where at this point in the car there was something or some substrate that partly helped with smooth transport and motion generation and this part over here also did it but in some other mixture of functions. Right? Seems so ridiculous it's almost impossible to think about. Right? Okay, how are we sure that we end up with a good design that's modular? Usually in engineering design, when we're writing out our functional requirements, we want to focus on these independent functions and say as little as possible about what we think the structure is going to be or the product that's going to realize those requirements. So let's boil down our very complex system over here into a set of two functional requirements. We want something that allows us to open cans and another one that allows us to open bottles. Those are two functional requirements. Now that we have our set of functional requirements, now it should be relatively easy to think about pieces of design that will support those functions. If one of our requirements is open a can, well, let's make a sharp tip so that we can puncture the top of the can. Pretty straightforward, right? And same for opening bottles. And we come up with this very complex artifact on the right-hand side. There's a third functional requirement that's implicit in this design. What's that? You got to be able to hold it, that's right. What else? What can you and what can't you do in regards to cans and bottles with this particular design?
Open them, but you can't seal them back up.
Okay, you can't seal them back up, right? There's lots of things that they also can't do.
Another functional requirement is we're never going to try and open a can and bottle at the same time, right? The design here, just by looking at it, at least it's pretty difficult to do, right? There's lots of things that you can't do. So again, a good set of functional requirements should have said open bottles, open cans, do it with just being able to hold the can with one hand and the can opener with another. We're assuming that the user is never going to need to open a can and bottle at the same time, and so on and so forth. It's often easy to think of the obvious things about what it should do, but what are the implicit things that it doesn't have to do or should not be able to do? Okay, so now we're getting closer and closer to HCI. Let's talk about software design or software engineering design. I mentioned there's a sister course to HCI, which is software engineering. A big part of that course is dedicated to sitting down with your users who say, I wish I could carry out this need, or there's something I wish I could do with software that's hard to do with my current software, and boil that those vague statements down into a very clean, precise set of functional requirements. What functionality should the software have? Okay. Let's talk about design principles in software engineering. There's lots of different principles or processes that have been proposed. Here's one design principle that most good coders follow, which is code, compile, execute, and debug, and repeat that process as quickly as possible. I had a student colleague in my student days when we were doing our master's thesis together. He wrote code for 8 months without compiling it. So he left himself a whole month to debug and validate and so on. A month should be more than enough time, right? Important to get down all the code and make sure you got everything there. We'll debug the last month and so on. As you can imagine, my friend did not quite make it all the way through the program. Iterate tightly and often as much as you can, and take it as far in the extreme as you can. So I will try and give you a live demo here. I'm going to write a very sophisticated program, which is a program that's going to add two numbers together. So I'm going to write it in Python, so there's no compiling, but I'm going to code, execute, and debug, and I'm going to cycle through that as fast as possible. Is there a second hand on that clock? Yes, there is. Okay. Time how many seconds it takes me to get through this loop. We'll see how we do. Okay. I'm going to use a very simple editor, VI. Okay, here's version 1.0. Okay, so far so good. Okay. How many seconds per cycle? Anybody counted? No? Okay. Try it yourself and time yourself. Okay. Obviously, we're dealing with a pretty simple situation here. It depends on the code, but iterate as tightly and quickly and as often as you can. When you get in the habit of doing this well, during this cycle, you're making predictions about what you should see when you run the code, right? As long as you're writing the code, you should be forming the prediction. When you now run it and the code does what you expect it to do, good, you're all right to go on to the next iteration. If it doesn't, stop, debug, and around you go, right? What is the minimal amount of code or functionality that you can have, that you can add, and still make a prediction about what the system should do when you rerun it? Okay. Again, there's people out there that might argue that that's not the best thing to do. Another design principle, which again, we're going to spend a lot of time talking about in this course, is data hiding, right? You're showing the interface to your user. You're most of the time trying to hide as much of the functionality as you can, in most cases. Okay. Those are design principles or kinds of rules of thumb that you might follow in good software design.
design process is again a particular way of translating need into, in this case, a software product. The oldest and most well-known design process is known as the waterfall model, where you have very clearly defined phases during software development. You carry out one after the other. If any of you know anything about software engineering, you've probably seen this before. As we've already mentioned, spend some time trying to write clear requirements. The more precise your requirements are, the easier the rest of the phases are going to be, right? If you write, your code should run quickly, that's a requirement, but what do you mean by quickly, right? Define everything as precisely as you can. Once you have a very precise set of requirements, then you can sit down and design the software. This does not mean writing code, but creating objects and classes, interfaces, which pieces of your code are going to talk to which other pieces, design everything as much as you can, and only at the third step do you sit down and actually start writing code. So most of you that have written code for classes here at UVM, I would imagine 80 or 90% of your time is involved in actually writing and maybe debugging the code. If you go and work for a big software firm, you're probably spending about 10% of your time coding and 90% of your time on all these other things. If you specify well, design well, have ways of testing your software well, implementation and writing the code becomes pretty straightforward. Okay. Test your code, validate, deploy, and away we go. Okay. Those are some principles and design processes that are specific to software design. Let's talk now about HCI, or interactive system design. So like software engineering, we're trying to create an interactive system or write code that allows a human user to carry out some desired function. In HCI, there's a big user interface component, there are additional requirements that we're trying to meet, which have things to do with accessibility, usability, acceptability, engagement, and so on. And we're going to talk about these in a moment. So the requirements we've been talking about so far are usually known as functional requirements. So functional in the sense that they relate specifically to what is the function that the software should carry out. These more global, somewhat vague requirements are known as non-functional requirements because they don't explicitly have to do with the function of the software itself, right? Regardless of what the function of your system is going to be, if it's going to be used by a lot of users, it should be accessible regardless of the function. It should be usable, and so on. Okay. Testing whether your functional requirements are met is pretty straightforward. So a functional requirement might be our software should return a response to the user's query in 200 milliseconds or less, right? You can imagine a test that will validate that requirement. Do you actually return a query in 200 milliseconds or less? Yes or no? Pretty easy to test, right? If you say the system should be accessible and it should be usable. What is a test for usability? How would you know whether your software has met this non-functional requirement? Something that's not specific to the function of the software itself, something about the global properties of the software. So let's think about it. You develop your software and you sell it on an app store and you claim that your system is very usable. Why would I believe you?
You can just say like 90% of testers were able to do such and such a task in such and such a time.
Okay, so that's a functional requirement, right? They were able to carry out this task in such and such a time. That's related to the function or the task itself. Can we come up with a way of testing the usability of the system without referring specifically to the functionality of the system or the task that the person is trying to carry out with your system?
Do a side-by-side test with a popular app that does something similar?
Absolutely, right? 4 out of people chose my app over the current best, most popular app on the App Store, right? There's other things you could do to test usability or these more global, vague requirements that don't have to do with the functionality itself. Okay. So if that's the case, right, we're going to have to perform a test with users. Which two apps do they prefer, mine or somebody else's? So unlike the waterfall model that we just saw with software design, where you're flowing from requirements to design and implementation validation and so on, user testing is front and center in design processes for HCI, which you're going to get a lot of experience doing in the last 4 weeks of this class. Right? You develop a prototype of your system, and you expose it to some users, and they do something with your system. What does the result of that test tell you about how accessible or usable or acceptable or engaging your system is? And again, we're going to talk about that. What are the tests that should be performed with your users? And once you do, how do you take the data you get back from your users and measure these non-functional requirements? Okay. We're not going to talk too much about requirements or physical and conceptual design. Physical design is actually sitting down with Leap Motion or Google Glass and understanding the hardware side of things. Conceptual design is this idea of, coming back to this idea of the conceptual framework of the system or the context. Who are the users? Who are the stakeholders? We're going to deploy this system out into the world, and it's going to have these repercussions. If 10% of the population starts wearing Google Glass, what is that world going to look like? If it's 50% or 90%, what's that world going to look like? Right? Sort of thinking about the bigger picture or bigger context of whatever it is that you're developing. Prototyping and envisionment, we'll talk about that a little bit later. Prototyping and sort of envisioning what are the versions of this system that we might have. And we've already talked about requirements. You might craft a set of functional requirements and non-functional requirements, do some initial user testing, and go back and completely change your requirements. There were things that you weren't aware of before user testing, right? My ASL educational software should work equally well for righties and lefties, right? You might miss that in the first version of requirements. Did you have a question? Okay, so let's, we're going to spend the rest of lecture four here unpacking these four non-functional requirements. A lot of stuff in HCI is kind of vague and obvious on the surface. What's the tricky part is unpacking them and making them objective and testable and precise. Right? So accessible should be accessible to a wide range of the human population. Right? So if you want to think about how accessible your software is, it's usually easier to think about the inverse of that or the converse of that, which is how exclusionary is your software, right? You test out your prototype of your Leap Motion device, and 10% of your users are reporting, it didn't work for me at all. It didn't recognize any of the gestures I was showing, right? You might have been unintentionally excluding lefties. Okay. So again, we can do this starting with obvious things like physical exclusion. Is this something that's going to be used by young people? Might it be someone in a wheelchair? Can they actually literally reach the software, right? Is the mouse too big or too small for someone's hand? We talked about this with Leap Motion. Right? Conceptual exclusion, right? Again, these are ones that are a little bit trickier. What are the different expectations that people bring to the same piece of software? So what are their expectations about cause and effect relationships, right? These can often be confusing. When I was trying to teach my father to use computers a few years back, trying to explain the difference between a slow and a fast double click, or a single and a double click, right? A double click that is slow enough, someone who's not acting fast enough is interpreted as two single clicks. But if you haven't quite gotten the idea that there is a difference between single and double clicks, it can be incredibly confusing, right? Okay. Becomes difficult for users in that situation to form a mental model of what the system is doing, right? I clicked on this icon once and it did one thing. Then I clicked on it again and it did something completely different. Right? That doesn't make a lot of sense to me. This icon or this menu option should always do the same thing. Why is it doing two different things? It's doing two different things because unbeknownst to you, you single-clicked or double-clicked, right? You haven't formed a mental model that there are these distinctions or these two separate ways with just a click to interact with an icon or a menu item and so on. Okay, economic exclusion, we'll talk about this again. There was a big push several years ago known as the One Laptop Per Child initiative. It's still going. You can go and have a look at the website. The idea here was about 10 years ago to create a laptop that cost $100 or less and get it to people in the developing world. Make sure that the developing world is not left behind as the computer revolution continues. Since that time, another kind of computer called smartphones have come along, or just cell phones, which are much more cost-effective than laptops. So the One Laptop Per Child initiative is having a hard time because laptops are becoming, in a lot of parts of the world, outdated. Okay, we talked about cultural exclusion last time, right? You're writing software for your interface. You want to make an intuitive interface, so you're not going to put any text on the screen describing things. You realize that everyone should know that a leftward pointing arrow means forward and a backward right-hand pointing arrow, I got that backwards tonight. Right-hand pointing arrow means forward, left pointing arrow means back, right? You don't need to put forward and back on your play bar, right? Depends on who you're developing the software for. Okay, social exclusion. What happens if you deploy some social software and it's used by very few people, right? Most recent killer apps only got going when there was enough users to generate collaborative synergies and get things going, right? How long does it take? How many people do you need? And what kind of social dynamics need to occur for your software to be accessible, to be usable? Okay, so an example of this one laptop per child idea and this idea of cultural exclusion. This is the Sugar interface, which was an early prototype for the interface for the One Laptop Per Child initiative. How would you interpret the icons that I've circled if you were a very young person in a small village in a developing country? What would those icons mean to you? Somebody comes to your village and donates a laptop to you and your friends. What does this one mean to you?
A game?
How do you know that?
I'm guessing that's what it means to me.
Why does it mean that to you? This is the point, right?
Well, because it's a very simple game, you know, you play with rocks. I mean, it could be.
Could be. What particular kinds of games does this look like? Games that you might be familiar with.
Connect Four, checkers,
or chess, or something like that. Is a small child in a small village in a developing country going to have been exposed to checkers or chess? Maybe not. I don't know. How about this one?
Drawing lines with color.
How did you know that?
Looks like an artist's palette.
Okay, so same question, right? How many young children in a small village would know what it means? How about this one? This one was a particularly poor choice. Right? It was meant to be a visual metaphor, right? It doesn't say on here, there's no text indicating exactly what it means.
I would have said volcano.
Volcano, right? And that's how it was interpreted by a lot of people in field trials. So children that realized they were one of these children being shown on the screen ran in the opposite direction. Right? Not a good choice. A famous example of a visual metaphor and cultural exclusion gone horribly wrong. Right? It seems, and again, the idea here was supposed to be to make a very intuitive, obvious interface. Right? We're simplifying this interface for young people who are, this is their first experience, maybe with technology in general, let alone a laptop. Right? Think carefully about who is going to be looking at the screen and making assumptions about what means what on the screen. Okay. So we talked a little bit about accessibility. That one's kind of easy. You can imagine some tests to test whether you're excluding members of your user population. Usable, I love this quote from 1990. Usable can be easily defined as easy to use, easy to learn, flexible, and engenders a good attitude in people. I think the definition is even more vague than the word itself, right? So let's try and boil this down again to more and more specific things that are testable. We could sit down with our users and actually measure how efficient a person carries out an activity. So again, we're now bringing back in maybe some of the specific functionality of the system. Somebody mentioned this before, right? How long does it take someone to get from start to finish of the task? How effective is it? So they may be very efficient, but not very effective. So not all the pieces of functionality that they need to carry out the task are there. Is it obvious, the sequence? Is everything available to effectively carry out what you want to do? How easy is it to learn the system, and how easy is it to remember how to do things when you come back to the software the next time? So let's break this into two things. First of all, how would you measure whether the system was learnable or memorable? Second question, what sorts of design principles would you put in place to make sure that it's learnable and memorable? So let's start with the first one, measurement. You deploy a prototype to some users, and you want to see how easily they learn the system. What would you measure? How would you know? Have them come back and do what?
Do it without discovering, having to do any discovery. I mean, that, it's also remembering, but I'm just saying learning is...
Okay.
I mean, if you learn something, you know, that means you know how to do it. So that means you remember.
They're related, right? They're not exactly the same thing, and we'll talk about that in a moment, right? But remember the Skinner box, right? If you want to see if something or someone is able to learn, you're obviously going to have to iterate something over time, right? How else can you measure how learnable your system is? If it's difficult to learn how to use a system, what does a user tend to do? Absolutely, it takes longer, although some of your users may just naturally take longer to use computers. They may not be computer experts, they just tend to work slowly with computers. So if some of your users take longer than others, is it because the system is difficult to learn how to use, or it's just natural variation in your user population? Right? Again, we want to be able to tease these things apart.
I was going to say combine that test with the number of back steps that people.
Absolutely. How often do they reverse direction, right? We're going to talk about navigation in a little bit, right? How often do they have to go back and do something again? How often do they get lost? What does it mean if somebody gets lost in your system? Okay, in the modern age, what do we do if you can't figure out the system?
Give up.
Okay. No, we don't give up in the modern system. You do what? Click the help button if there is a help button. Right. The best help button in the world these days has a hard time competing with open up a new tab and Google it, right? Okay. So assuming it's in a browser, measure how often your user switches to Google and looks up a keyword that can also be found in your system, right? You could automate that whole testing process. Okay. How often do they Google it? Let's focus specifically now on memory. How do you know if somebody remembers when they come back to your system again, how do you know whether they remembered how the system works without asking them?
Maybe measure how quickly they go through the same process.
Absolutely, right? So maybe they skip over a bunch of things because they remember, okay, I don't need to look at this. I know how to get to this point and continue from where I left off. Or I've gotten much, much faster at it. So you can get faster just because you've learned the system, but memory itself, right, means you can skip over things. I remember these intermediary steps, I don't need to carry them out. So yes, learning and memory are close, but not quite the same thing. Right? Safety, obviously that's important, that doesn't require much discussion. Utility, which is closely related to efficiency and effectively, does it do the things that people actually want to get done, right? So I'm sitting down with the software, I'm at point A, and I want to get to point B, but your system forces me to reach B prime, which is close. So that's not quite what I wanted to do, but it's very, very close. Your system might be incredibly efficient and effective and easy to learn and remember and safe. It was a pleasure to use. I got from A to B prime, but
utility is not quite what I want it to be. It's not quite what I had in mind. Vice versa, I sit down with your system and your system has high utility. I want to get from point A to point B. I did it with your software. I got exactly to point B, but it took me 137 steps to get there. High utility, but low efficiency, right? So a lot of these general HCI terms sort of cover a lot of more specific things that people like or dislike about software or artifacts. And obviously, we're trying to maximize these as much as we can.
Okay.
So now we have a little bit of a better handle on what we mean by usability, effectiveness, utility, and so on. How do we make a system that's usable? How do we make a system that is maximally learnable and memorable and so on? Again, we've mentioned this already, but early focus on users and tasks. Create a very, very simple prototype. Give it to your users and don't tell them anything. Let them explore the system. If they very quickly figure out that there's some implicit sequence or flow to the system and they start working their way through it, great, right? You're already starting to learn things. As your users are using the system, write things down, or better yet, record it automatically with software that's observing the user's interaction, right? I asked you to time my code execute debug cycle, right? You can actually put a number to certain certain interactions, and those objective measurements are a lot better than saying that user seemed to enjoy my software, that user didn't seem to enjoy my software as much, right? So design, test, measure, and redesign as often as possible, where test is usually with users rather than the author of the software. Right? Test with it, with as many different kinds of users as possible. Or maybe as you're cycling through this process, you're inviting more and more and a more diverse group of testers to use your prototype as you go. There's a lot of factors that go into usability or go into any of these four HCI factors, and they're interdependent. Some of them are independent, some of them are interdependent. So often, improving one factor may adversely affect the other factor. So I'll go back to the previous slide in a moment, and let's see where some of these antagonisms or some of these interdependencies exist. Where might improving any one of these five usability factors decrease another one?
Well, I think the most common one's probably like adding more utility but losing the ease of use.
Okay, so why would increasing utility decrease ease of use, which you could probably put in with efficiency?
You would lose your balance between having lots and lots of features but
absolutely. You got a lot of users. They all start at point A. And user 1 wants to go to B. User 2 wants to go to C. User 3 wants to go to E, and so on, right? There's a lot of different ways that your users are going to use the system. You want to support them all, so it's probably not going to be very efficient. You're going to have to advertise a lot of features or a lot of paths through your system. What are some other interdependencies here?
Safety and efficiency. Okay. Improving safety might lower the efficiency of your program. If you have to do execute more code and do extra things to ensure that the system's safe.
Absolutely, right? So this is one of the most obvious ones. The more safe or paranoid your system is, the less efficient it's going to be, right? Are you sure you want to perform function X? Did you really mean this? Are you sure? Let me ask again, and so on, right? That's not very efficient, but it certainly is safe. Other interdependencies here. Any Linux users here? People that work at the command line? Yeah? Okay. What can you tell me about commands in Linux?
If you know them all, you can work a lot faster, but if you don't know any of them.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right? So Linux is, as long as you, it's not very learnable, it's not very memorable, right? Listing all of the files in a directory is ls, right? You probably wouldn't have guessed that if you didn't know that. You type list or show me files or show files. A lot of cryptic commands that take quite a while to learn and remember, but once you know them, if you sit a Linux user down or somebody who works at the command line next to somebody else who's using a GUI or a graphical user interface, the Linux person usually wins most of the time, right? There's an efficient set of procedures that they can get through a lot faster than someone who's using the GUI. Okay. Again, that doesn't say anything about the pros and cons of Linux versus a GUI interface. Again, it depends on your users. Most modern operating systems these days offer a command line interface and a GUI. You pick.
Okay.
This is another good one to really know how usable your system is. This is something you see with everyday technology or even just simple tools. When a tool is really, really usable, it's simple and obvious, everybody knows how to use it, you just stop thinking about it altogether. Right? And the telltale sign of that is if you ask somebody who's using a tool or an artifact to describe what they're doing, they will often, instead of saying, I'm using the noun, the tool, I'm verbing, right? The noun becomes a verb, right? I'm hammering in a nail rather than using a hammer. I'm driving rather than operating a vehicle. Okay. What are examples of verbification in software?
Googling,
right? We've already mentioned that one. Tweeting. What else? Skyping, yes, right? There's a proliferation of verbs in the English language in the last 5-10 years, right? Because of these software successes that are so easy, everyone knows what it means to Google something, right? I'm operating the Google interface by typing something into a box and clicking search, right? You don't need to say that. It's so obvious because it's something that we do. All right. Great example of when this immediately goes wrong, right? When something goes wrong, you're immediately conscious of the tool separate from yourself, right? It's not a part of yourself. It's the tool that made a mistake, not me. Okay. So ask your users, right? Give your software a memorable name and see if they say, I'm Xing rather than I'm using X. Okay. Let's talk about acceptability. This is related to, but very, in some cases, very different from usability. The difference between acceptable and usable is it something that someone's going to use in the wild, right? So you might be developing a software prototype. You bring in a bunch of users to your cubicle and have them work with the software. They say, yes, this is much more usable than the current piece of software that we're using. You deploy it. Everyone seemed to like it, but out in the broader world, it's not accepted. People don't seem to be using it as much, right? Why is that? Because there's more context out there in the world than there is in the lab setting where you're doing your user testing, right? I mentioned PeopleSoft last time, right? People have a surprisingly hard time learning it. It's already not very usable, but even above and beyond that, people have a hard time because they're much less willing to put in the time to learn function X and function Y for political reasons. It's being forced on them, right? Is it convenient? Does it fit in with the user's life? Is it going to replace something else, right? A great example of this was the ebook revolution. So for those of you that read for pleasure, how many people still do it in print? Most of you? How many tend to prefer an e-reader over print? Still just a few. Okay, getting there, right? Why is it so difficult for e-reading to take over the book market, at least in recreational reading?
You have to buy the device first.
You have to buy the device, okay. Most of us have the device already, or something like it.
I think a lot of people on the screen to be kind of jarring.
Okay, right. So some of it is just being physically tired by looking at a screen all day. What else?
There's something to the idea of a gamification thing where it's not as satisfying.
Okay.
Seeing how much progress we've made in a book.
Okay, that's right. Could be. There might be a gamification element to it. A lot of distractions, right? If you're reading on a screen, there might be pop-ups and so on. Who knows? Exactly, right? Remember, there's the aesthetic sense there, right? We're deploying Kindle and all these things to try and replace kicking back and not looking at a screen and reading a book, right? That's a hard barrier to get over, and who knows, maybe we'll never get over that, right? The interface may be beautiful, right? You may have a screen, it works in natural sunlight. When you swipe across the screen, you see a page actually curling and then flipping over. It's really, really close to holding a book, but there's something that's always missing, right? That's not usability now, that's acceptability, right? If I'm reading for pleasure, there's something about just holding a book. Doesn't matter how usable or efficient your e-reader is, I just might not accept it for those kinds of reasons. Right? Okay, so that again relates to cultural and social habits and economic and social issues that we've already talked about. Okay. Let's get to the last one here, which is the most difficult one to pin down, which is this idea of how engaging is the experience cast by your interactive technology, right? So if something is engaging, it's very subjective, but most people would say I got pulled into the experience, right? If it wasn't engaging, I wasn't drawn in, I didn't enter into the world created by this interface. Right? Somebody who sees a great movie or reads a great book or observes a great work of art, right? I got lost in it, right? If you listen to people describing their interaction with that artifact, you'll hear things like that, right? What does that really mean, right? There's something about a sense of immersion, and what is it? What casts that illusion of being drawn into something? Video games are the obvious example where they really try and maximize engagement, right? It's really about casting an illusion when the person interacts with the system. Okay. So if it's a video game or it's a piece of educational software that you're all going to create, is the user intellectually challenged? Are they creatively inspired by it, right? If it's something that they're trying to do, you're trying to reach that sweet spot between boring the user and frustrating the user, right? Whatever the system is, it shouldn't be too easy or too hard. How do you know? You can ask them, and usually they'll tell you something about their subjective experience of time, right? Time flew by. I didn't realize how much time I had put into that, right? Web surfing alone is a great example, right? You go looking for a term on Wikipedia, and an hour later you're on some other page, and you don't remember how you got there. Okay. What other aspects go into engagement? Usually the software, the experience, has something to do with your own identity. Your personality is somehow reflected in the system. There's some ideological component to what you're doing. Apple capitalized on this a few years ago with their advertising campaign. Do you remember the I'm a Mac and I'm a PC advertising campaign? Which of these two characters do you identify with? Okay, this is nice that the contrast is washed out because it doesn't say which person is the Mac and which person is the PC. But you can probably guess given Apple's advertising strategies, right? Okay. So again, that's part of forming an allegiance to the company or the software. Is it really something that draws me in? This is part of me. It says something about me that I'm using this technology. Creating something that's engaging is usually difficult above and beyond the first three because you usually also have to make your system adaptive, right? Your educational system is going to have to adapt what it's presenting to the user as the user gets better at signing various ASL letters. Right? That can be tricky. When do you speed things up? When do you slow things down? When do you know that you're losing your user? They're exiting this engagement that they've been drawn into with the system. How do you know when they're starting to be distracted or they might leave and go do something else? Can you pull them back in? Narrative. Does the system tell a good story, right? In a video game, that might be literal. In interactive systems, it might be a little bit more metaphorical. But usually, there's some sense of navigation, right? You're trying to get from point A to point B, or you're trying to explore and understand the landscape. What is the narrative that your system is drawing the user through? Okay. And then again, this idea of immersion. Do they feel literally inside or connected with the interface, this idea of striking a balance between not boring the user and not frustrating them relates to an idea from a psychologist Mihaly Csikszentmihalyi. And luckily on the quiz tonight, you won't have to pronounce Mihaly's last name. Mihaly wrote this great book called Flow. Has anybody read Flow? Fantastic, fantastic book. Goes through and he interviewed a lot of people that were at the top of their profession. So top athletes, top programmers, top academics, top politicians. When you're in the zone, what do you experience from a psychological point of view? And these people from lots of different walks of life who are masters in their own area describe very common psychological experiences. Time seemed to slow down. I had plenty of time to wind up the tennis racket and hit the ball. It was effortless. Right? You hear that same account of things seeming to slow down and everything just becomes an effortless flow. Right? Again, this gets back to this idea of your subjective sense of time. Right? If you're fighting with the software and you're pushing it and trying to get from point A to point B, that's not a very engaging experience. Right? If we, the user and the software, together got from point A to point B, that's a much more engaging interactive system. Okay, so we've got a couple more minutes left. We'll start in on lecture 5. I apologize, I didn't put the slides of Lecture 5 up until midday, so if you don't have a copy of Lecture 5, no problem, we're not going to get too far into it today. Okay, just switch back to the schedule for a moment. We've just spent some time in Lecture 4 talking about design philosophy and design process. So design process, what are the things you're going to do to turn requirements into a piece of software, and design philosophy, what's the best way to do that? How are you going to maximize your chances of ending up with an accessible, usable, acceptable piece of software? That's the design philosophy. Let's talk now about design principles, which are a little bit more about these rules of thumb. What are the things we're going to do along the way? So these design principles are usually part of a longer design process. Okay, so I've left up here at the beginning of Lecture 5 these global properties that we're trying to optimize or maximize in our system. On the surface, they're kind of vague. We're trying to unpack them and make them a little bit more specific. We know what we're supposed to be optimizing. How can we actually go about doing that now? So we're going to look at some of these design principles about how to maximize accessibility and usability. And so on. There's a long compound sentence somewhere in your textbook, which is, again, unfortunately quite vague, so we'll unpack this one as well. Here's a whole bunch of design principles. Help the user access, learn, and remember the system. Give them a sense of being in control, knowing what to do and how to do it and when. And we haven't talked really about control. When is the user in control and when is the software in control? When you're interacting with Leap Motion, when is it sensing you and when are you reacting to what it's showing you, right? We have this very tight feedback loop. How do you know when the user or the system is in control? We've talked a bit about safety and security already, and in a way that suits them. This gets back to usability and acceptability. Okay. So again, let's try and unpack some of these. If we want the user to be able to access, learn, and remember the system, what are the kinds of things we're going to have to do along the way? Well, the first thing is obviously present something on the screen or make a sound or do something, right? We've got to start somewhere in establishing this sensory motor loop, feedback loop between the user and the software. What do you show them, right? A lot of user interfaces show as little as possible. Unfortunately, some show too many, right? What should we show? Well, it depends, again, on things that are recognizable or memorable. Again, when we get to cognitive psychology, we're going to spend a lot of time talking about how the human visual system works. Turns out that it's easier for us to recognize things that we've seen before rather than remember them. And again, we're talking about psychology. You're a human being, you recognize much more easily than you remember, so it seems, why should we even be talking about this, right? If you're creating something to show on the screen, try and show the user something that they recognize rather than forcing them to remember, right? At the command line, there's nothing. You have to remember all the commands and pull them back, right? A GUI is predicated on the idea that you'll recognize everything here, and even if you're not quite sure where to go, you'll figure it out just by looking, right? On Macs, you've got red, yellow, and green in the top left. Why red, yellow, and green? Why not purple, brown, and black, or three other colors? What's special about, what do you recognize about red, yellow, and green?
Traffic lights.
Traffic lights, right? What is it about traffic lights? Why red, yellow, and green in traffic lights and as interface widgets?
Red is like stop or warning, green is, good or go.
Exactly, right? They're sort of positive or negative somehow, right? Generally speaking, right? Red means stop, right? So if I click red, it's going to stop this presentation, right? Stop means a lot of different things in different situations, but we have an intuition about what it means, right? If I'm a new Mac user, I've never seen a Mac user interface before, I figure it out pretty quickly, right? Okay, so things that are familiar, right? Make things visible through sound and touch. As just an example of your visual system and capitalizing on that when you're thinking about visibility and the idea that it's easier to recognize than remember. Let's look at an example. Okay, recognition is easier than remembering. How many mistakes are there? How many differences are there in this slide? You've all played this game before. I know it's late in the day and you're tired.
Is there six?
Six, I hear six, I hear eight. Anyone found more than eight differences? The fact that I'm getting different numbers suggests it's maybe not that trivial. 10? 11, okay. Why does it take so long? Not that it's taking you longer than my last class. Why does this take a while? What is it about your visual system that makes this difficult? Okay, so some things pop out immediately. Some of the differences are harder to spot than others. What is it about the things that pop out immediately? What is the feature of the things that pop out immediately that makes them pop out immediately? Why are some things easier to see than others? Some differences.
They exist or they don't exist.
Well, assuming we have a whole bunch of differences there. Yep.
Color.
Okay. What else is something that makes it obvious?
First one I noticed was the little kid's face, that one has the tongue out and one doesn't, because people are generally drawn to faces.
Absolutely, right? We're going to talk about that. The human visual system is evolved to lock onto faces first and then see everything else in your visual field. I don't know if they still have them, those internet ads where there's a human face or someone dancing, right? The human visual system is drawn to human bodies and human faces, right? And unexpected sounds.
I think the context of the changes, like
okay.
I noticed that there was a floppy disk.
Okay. Okay.
Because it don't eat those regularly.
Okay.
But the clock took me a little longer to see.
Okay. All right. So there's something surprising, right? A floppy disk doesn't exist in a baking pan, right? Things that are out of context.
Just out of curiosity, how many are there?
Good question, right? I was waiting till someone would ask. Okay. So this is difficult, right? Because you need to remember. So we're going to talk about saccades later. So in the human visual system, at all times, your eyes are saccading or jumping to different points in your visual field at about a tenth of a second. So here, if we were to actually record where your eyes are focused on the screen here, it would be here, and then you'd probably land here and correct to here. Then you might go here, here, and correct to here. Your saccades are being forced to make big jumps, right? You're having to compare this with this, and this with this, and this with this, and so on. You cannot do it simultaneously. Some of the big things, things that are large or things that are a very different color, you can, in some cases, pick up on it simultaneously. At one moment in time, you recognize that they're different. All the rest of them, you have to jump back and forth, and your brain has to remember as you saccade in that tenth of a second, what was there before? Was there four fingers or three fingers? Was there a tongue out? Was there not a tongue out? You've got to remember, and remembering is harder, right? So if the task, if this was a user interface, and the task that you had to carry out was find all the differences, this is maybe not a good interface. Because I haven't thought carefully about the details of the human visual system, and that it's harder to remember than recognize things, right? So can I change the interface to make things easier on you? Same task. Now, how many differences are there? How many? So definitely more than 11. Wasn't that the highest count, right? So you missed a bunch. Okay. Don't worry, everybody does. Oh, we get to 17.
Does the word remembering count?
Good catch, right? Okay. I actually didn't do that on purpose, and then when I made this, I realized that I had made a mistake, right? How many errors are there in the sentence to the right of the image? You've already caught one. There's a second that you missed. What?
Then.
There's a word missing, right? Another aspect of, in this case, your higher cognitive function, which is the brain is a prediction machine. If you read recognition is easier, your brain will automatically fill in then, right? Your brain was the first autocorrect algorithm, right? It puts it in there, and you missed it because it's a systemic error here, right? It exists in both slides, so you don't recognize or you don't immediately register a change, right? I mentioned this when we talked about attention, right? Your attention is immediately drawn to differences, things that change, right? This is just a different way of drawing this interface, not even an interface, that accounts for, makes things easier for your visual system and your cognitive system, right? You can do the same thing with lots of different kinds of visual interfaces. Okay, with that little game, this is probably a good place to end for today. Have a good weekend. Remember, there's a quiz due tonight, and deliverable one is due Monday night. Good luck.